presentation and the opportunity to be here. So since this is supposed to be a general talk, I will try to define everything. Symplectic, so I want a manifold with even dimension, with a two-form, that locally looks like the sum of dxi dy y. So usually I want x to be compact, or x is total space of a negative bundle. Over compact Kähler. And sometimes, but only at the very end, there's going to be also omega going from x into there's going to be an involution on x, so that omega squared is the identity, and the pullback of a symplectic form is minus omega. So this looks like conjugation. So if you think about Cn, then that's you can take a conjugation. Oh yeah, actually one more thing. So enumerative means you should get some kind of numbers. So maybe get some kind of numbers. They should really be in Z. And you like to think of them as being counts of curves. So to some extent, this is motivated by classical enumerative geometry. But the applications are to some extent a symplectic topology. So in classical enumerative geometry, what you might do is count curves inside of some kind of complex manifold. And you'd like to take curves to be, so by curves I mean complex curves. Which is the same as Riemann surfaces. But possibly nodal or worse. And so when you want to count curves, then it should be curves of fixed genus and in fixed homology class. And maybe passing through some constraints. So one example, if you take two points, there is only one line through them. So for two points in CP2 is one. If you want to take four lines in CP3, that's two. And some of which sounds quite a bit different. If you look at the number of lines on a generic quintic hypersurface. Inside of CP4. So something that looks like the zero set of x1 to the fifth plus 2x2 to the fifth plus x5 to the fifth. It should be generic. So it's just cut out by degree 5 polynomial. So this number is 2875. What?
What do you mean by generic?
Well, there's a whole bunch of polynomials that encode this.
You mean except for as a risky
house? Exactly. Yeah.
And if it's not generic, then what happens? You get too many, or you don't get any?
So if it's not generic, then you might sometimes get either too many, but if it comes in a big dimensional family. But in this case, you might get things that count, that count with multiplicity. But I mean, somehow the number is still 2875, even if you take a better one. So in this case, everything is good. So all the spaces you're looking at have expected dimension. It actually makes sense to pose this problem. So, but in general, the trouble is that spaces of curves usually just don't have expected dimension. And second, are often singular.
So what's expected dimension? Am I supposed to expect 2875?
No. So that's the expected number. But so if you take a generic quintic threefold, then you will expect that the dimension of a space of lines in it is zero.
Okay.
Now, so the reason for this is you look at the deformation theory of a line on a quintic threefold, and then you can just look at the early characteristic of some sheaf. So essentially, you'll be looking at something like H0, dimension of H0 of U star pullback of Tx. Minus the dimension of which one you start pullback. Yeah, so U is one of the curves, is a map parameterizing your curve. And that's the expected dimension. So it just tells you, it asks about moving the curve, essentially. And in some cases, there may be automorphisms, so you have to divide out by the automorphisms. So in case of the lines, actually, with automorphisms. So what this all says is that counting problems might be difficult to both pose and to solve. So if you take something like quintic threefold, this number is actually independent of a degree. So if you ask for degree 10 curves, the expected dimension is still zero, so you can still ask for a number. But it's not clear if this number is actually finite. So Clemens conjecture says it is finite. But I think it's been done up to degree 10, maybe 11. But after that, it's not known. So the solution is to count holomorphic maps. So what these things are is You take a Riemann surface, maybe there's even two things. So Riemann surface, you know, is a complex curve. So I will usually be drawing it like this, but really what this means might mean something like this. But this is just easier to draw. So this is a Riemann surface.
So you're allowing singularities, right?
Yes. Possibly not all. And connected. Let's see. So I'm allowing singularities, but I'm not allowing anything terrible. I don't want triple points. And we want to look at maps U into XJ. And this J is what is called almost complex structure on X. And what this means is that J operates on a tangent bundle, and J squared is minus Y identity. So in general, I want X to be symplectic. So if I have X omega, then I want J to be omega compatible. So what this means is that omega J V W is minus omega V J W. Maybe I should call this V prime. And omega VJV is positive for V in for non-zero vectors. So that's how this defines a metric. Well, that's sort of a minor point. It's not really going to come up. Okay, so what I need to define is this pseudo holomorphic. So what this means is that there's this thing called debar operator, debar ju, which is by definition a half of du plus j composive du times j. So this thing is a map between tangent bundle from here to here. And then you conjugate it by the two J's. And pseudo-holomorphic means that this is zero. So this is basically the same as Cauchy-Riemann equations. If XJ is complex manifold. So local coordinates will give you precisely Cauchy-Riemann equations. So if you have a complex manifold, then it gives you this structure on tangent bundle. But the other way is not true. So instead of counting these curves, you could try to count these maps. So for example, if you look at the number of degree one maps from P1 into P2, complex projective spaces that pass through two points, holomorphic maps. That's again one. So any of these maps has to parameterize this line, and essentially there's only one such thing up to equivalence. Because if you take one map, you can compose it with automorphism P1, it'll give you another map. But up to equivalence is one. So if you take P1 into P3 through four lines, that's gain 2. And the same thing on quintic. Quintic hypersurface in P4. You can get the same number. So it's kind of nice the numbers are the same. So in general,
does the point that this is an easier deformation space to compute?
Yes. I haven't gotten there yet, but yeah. In fact, the first application of this is going to be precisely with easy deformation space. So image of map from a surface of genus G into X. Is a curve of genus G prime, which is less or equal than G. So the genus can drop in principle. So for example, you can take a map from a torus and map it to a sphere. But you cannot do it the other way around. So if a map is of degree D, then the curve is going to be, I guess I said beta before. The curve is going to be of degree beta prime, which is less or equal than beta. Now, so what I mean by this, so if you own a projective manifold, then so this just says that the difference is positive. But for symplectic point of view, this just says omega beta prime is less or equal than omega beta. And in a sense, this says energy of the maps. So the first equality above. So the genus equality of course holds if G is zero. If this thing has genus zero, it cannot drop anymore. That's certainly true. So the second equality may hold and this is my, if enough constraints are imposed. So now the case when it holds is if the degree is as small as it can be. So for example, in this case, if the degree is one, it cannot be any smaller. It has to be positive degree. So as an example, the number of degree d at genus, number of genus zero, degree d curves in P2 for 3d minus 1 points is actually the same as the number of holomorphic maps u from p1 into p2. Of degree d, a pass through 3 minus 1 points. So the reason for this is that if you take some kind of map from here to here of degree d, its image could possibly be a curve of small degree. But if you take any such curve, it's not going to pass through this many generic points. So the dimension of a space of curves of degree d, rational curves, is 3d minus 1. So if you look at curves of smaller degree and put this generically, there aren't any, going to be any curves that pass through this. So the numbers end up being the same. So the advantage of this approach is that map counts so which is essentially Gromov-Witten invariants are essentially topological. So, for example, if you're considering maps like this, I didn't say if this j, little j, was fixed. So I could consider the fixed j. And if I consider fixed j, it doesn't matter which j I take, little j. The count would be different if I don't fix j, but if I fix j, it's independent of a fixed j, little j. So I could fix j, or cross ratio of points on of 4 points on p1. I could just take those points and I could say where we should go. And the answer would be the same.
I'm a little confused. I mean, you're still using a holomorphic structure, though, right?
Yes.
So in one sense, this is topological enough. Independent of the complex structure.
So for example, if I consider a space of all cross ratios of 4 points, it's a p1.
Yes.
And as I move if I consider maps with a fixed cross ratio, that number is independent of a cross ratio. So I can think of this p1 as being some kind of space of which I move around. And as I move around, it will not change. And before this was done for these general zero maps, this was completely not obvious for curves. The same state. So in particular, so from a topological point of view, this curve, I put mark points 1 and 2 in here and 3 and 4 in here. So this is cross ratios of, say, 0, depending on how you define cross ratio. Gives you the same count as this curve. I'm putting 4 mark points, I'm taking cross ratio. The cross ratios of these two things are different. Maybe 0 and infinity. But they give the same count. And you can use this to actually get a recursive formula for ND, for this number. I'm going to define this ND. recursion for ND. No. So you take 3D minus 1 points and you take a, and you replace one of these points by intersection of two lines, and then you say that these two points should go to the lines, you go to first to other points, and there are points distributed random places. You consider these maps and that map, those maps, and we just compare the two sides. So it's actually a fairly straightforward argument. So in this case, you could get a degree zero term on this thing, and then it's just intersection of these two lines. But on this here, neither of the components could be degree zero. So they're all going to be positive degree, which means the total degree has to be d. So on each line, they're going to be degree smaller than d. While on this side, you get something degree d. So precisely gives you recursion. So you get this recursion, and this is called Confucius formula. So this is actually proved in Ron's Tian's paper in JDG 95. And this includes extension to a higher dimensional projective space. So what this does is this completely solves the very old classical problem. So back in the 19th century, we got up to degree 4. And then they stopped. So Ron has an argument which can do it in a more classical way, but basically his argument is actually relative Gromov-Witten invariants. It just came up a bit earlier, but translation to relative Gromov-Witten invariants. And he did not get this simple formula, this conservative formula, at first.
Explicit numbers,
yes. So there's no closed formula for this. There's an explicit recursion. There's generating function that satisfies the differential equation.
And the differential equation is integrable, or
the Pamela type, or one of those? Yeah, it's Pamela 6, I guess. No. Because then I wouldn't get to tell you what I wanted to tell you. So really the case I'm more interested in is that is when this is so often when the map counts are not the same as curve counts. So that's the case which is the more interesting aspect of topology. So the main example is what is called Calabi-Yau threefold. So this is to say that X is a complex manifold of dimension 3 and first term class 0. And the main example is this quintic threefold, the quintic hypersurface. So in this case, expected dimension of curves in any genus G and of any degree D is 0. And that means that you should expect. So you should somehow get. Okay, finite number. And G beta. This total number of cars in each genus and degree.
Could you explain to me what the difference is between the maps and the curves? Or?
Yeah. So cars is what sits inside. Cars is the image of the map.
Okay.
So cars is just here, and so inside of X, and a map is something that maps to it. And that, now we're going to see where the difference comes in. So, and what about maps? U from P1 to X. So I'm fixing P1 as genus 0. And let's say of, so let's say that the homology class of this map is Bayesian. So it's going to give me a curve. So we're going to get image curve C, which is just U P1. It's going to be a curve of genus 0. It may be singular, but still genus 0. And in homology class, beta over D. So in H2X, this is for some D and Z plus. So what can happen here is you have this U from P1 into C, sort of X, is D to one cover. The Z goes to Z squared, Z to D. For example. So the first thing to notice is that if D is positive, if D is bigger than 1, the space of such maps is actually positive dimensional. This is denoted m bar 0 p1d or cd. So there's certainly infinitely many maps. But nevertheless, we still can get a Gromov-Witten invariant here, which is the virtual count of maps. And so the next thing I'll say is one indication of why this is topological. Well, you know, you've got a bunch of curves inside of a manifold. Just count how many there are. That's what I want to do, okay? I mean, if there is infinitely many of them, then I guess you can do it. But if there are finitely many, I can ask how many are there, right? So you could ask, maybe you should count with some sign, right? Maybe. But
what's the virtual count?
Yes, so I'm not going to define it completely, but I'll give an indication. Okay, so we want to count solutions of d bar j u equals to zero. So here u is going to be a map from p1 into x, and the homology class beta. So this equation is not transverse. So to make it transverse, you have to deform something. Ideally, you would like to deform that. Nobody knows how to do this in general. I mean, in some cases you can, but to get finite count, we're going to deform equation. So instead of this equation, we're going to take d bar j u equals some kind of nu. One can ask, you know, so to understand what nu is, you have to understand what this equation really means. So if you take some kind of u of nu, so this is supposed to lie in some kind of space. So p1 lambda 0, 1, k star of p1, 0, 1, tensored, k star pullback of tx. And of course, there has to be some kind of smoothness condition. One very formal approach is to use the polyfold theory.
Is to use
the polyfold theory to formally define conditions of this nu. This depends on u. So there has to be some kind of smoothness condition. That can be given by polyfold theory. It can also be given by local approximations, which are only finite dimensional. So you only define it in small pieces, and they have to match up somehow together. But there is a way of saying what it means for this to be smooth. Yeah. Yes. Yes. So for a generic small nu, we get finite number.
And that number does not change. I mean, in other words, I can change different nus I can put there, I suppose.
Yes, as long as they are sufficiently small.
And I'll get the same number.
You get the same number. So the only subtle point is that nu may be multivalued. So you have to impose this smoothness condition, and because of the smoothness condition, sometimes you just cannot do it single valued. And
the problem with deforming the J is that you still may not get transversality.
Exactly, yes. Deforming J may not be enough to get transversality. So in some cases it is enough.
Then does it agree with this number?
With which?
With the number you defined below. I mean, the one with the nu. You know, if I deform the J, sometimes I get.
Yes. In those cases, they agree. Yes.
They agree.
Because deforming J is actually a special case of deforming nu. So in this case, it's actually possible to do it without this abstract stuff, just by deforming with J, but not with J on X, but on P1 cross X. And then you have to divide it by 1 over D cubed. So you get a rational number, but you control the denominator. The numbers still agree.
What's D cubed?
So essentially, if you take a hyperplane, so you can intersect this with a hyperplane, and that a positive hyperplane, and then this intersection cubed. So point of it is the denominators of this actually bounded in this case. They bounded in terms of beta. So, 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 So because it's multivalued, you have to be careful about how you count zeros. So you can only get it in a rational number. But for enumerative purposes, you really want to have integers. So first question you can ask is, you've got this curve, you've got all these maps nearby, now you deform this equation. So you should get a whole bunch of solutions nearby. So maybe I'll put this here. So this is sort of a deformed equation.
So this number independent of u is called Gromov-Witten invariant.
Yes. So the first thing is that number.
And it's also defined for us for the virtual count. What do you mean by virtual count?
Yes. Yeah. So number of solutions of a deform equation. That lie near G to one covers. U from P1 into C. So you've got this fixed curve C in there, and there's a huge big space in there. Well, so sometimes it's possible to say what it should be. Because if all you have is this isolated curve, if this curve is isolated, then it's actually possible to do. So what is called the early class of abstraction bundle. So abstraction bundle to moving the curve around, to moving this map around. Evaluated on the moduli space of degree d covers of a curve. And so in some cases, this is 1 over d cubed, what is known as a Spinwall-Morrison formula. And so this is true if C is isomorphic to P1, is isolated in X. And the normal bundle to C in X. So this normal bundle, so C1 of a tension bundle is 0. So this is a bundle of degree 2 in rank 2, of degree minus 2 in rank 2. So the ideal splitting is O of minus 1 plus O of minus 1. So it's the balance splitting. Okay, so if you assume that but you've got a whole bunch of all gen zero curves in X are super rigid. So what I mean by super rigid is this condition. Then you can do this for every one of these curves. Whenever you get a degree d cover, you get this contribution. And so you can actually express Gromov-Witten invariance in terms of these numbers. So that's going to be the sum over all d. So when you get. When you get this degree, it has to be integer in here. So the sum over all d dividing b, so maybe I'll take r dividing b, 1 over r cubed and 0 r. So one thing I want to point out, so this is this if. Yeah.
What is true if C is P1 isolated in X and the normal bundle is balanced? The equality with 1 over d cubed or the fact that the number of solutions
So this gives you this equality. So in order to say this thing, you take the Euler class of something. So whatever you take the Euler class of has to make sense. If it's not like this, your curve could be moving, and then you have a whole big moduli space in here. So this would be much worse. Okay, so this holds under this condition, but in all cases, this is defined. So you can use this thing, this box, and define this in terms of that. This is beta over R. So this is a lower triangle transformation, linear transformation. So in all cases, defines the curve counts n0 beta as a function of Gromov-Witten invariants, the beta less the beta prime less than the beta. So what I would say is one of the biggest conjectures in Gromov-Witten theory is that this should be curve counts, right? So this should be this non-negative integer. Let's say like this. So and maybe a stronger version n zero beta is a number of J-holomorphic curves, which is to say images of non-multiply covered maps. So U from P1 into X counted with sign and for a generic almost complex structure J.
And generalization,
So in this particular case, I only said this statement for Calabi-Yau free folds. So what I was going to do next is to give a list of where this possibly extends to. It's important to say that this is almost complex structure. The statement is false if you restrict to integrable complex structures.
But that definition may depend on J.
What? So the conjecture is that it doesn't. Well, so the way I define the super rigid actually means this splitting only makes sense if you have a complex manifold.
So you are assuming.
But if you have an almost complex structure, this definition does not make sense. There is a definition that generalizes this. In fact, part of this conjecture is that all the curves are super rigid in that other definition. So the definition here is that the cars don't move. So H0, we start pull back of a normal bundle to the curve, yeah, is 0. And that definition makes sense here. Is there going to be something else?
My understanding is that you're making the definition of these numbers by Mobius inversion.
Exactly, yes. Yeah. So
at least for so far.
Yes. So in higher dimensions, this is actually not a linear thing. So, and this is a kind of conjecture where you can run lots of tests. It's easily testable. Because Gromov-Witten invariants for many things are computable. Yes, exactly. So the principle here was that you assume what all the curves are as expected, you get some kind of relationship. So assume all curves C and X are as expected. So in this case, it's not difficult to say what it means. In other cases, maybe harder. So once you have this, then you get Gromov-Witten invariant of X G beta as a function of these little numbers, these curve counts, with G prime less or equal than G, beta prime less or equal than beta. And so if you put all this together, you get a correspondence between Gromov-Witten invariants, the curve count, and this is a lower triangular polynomial transformation. But the top term is actually just one. So in particular, it's invertible. And so this you get under the assumption, under this assumption. But this you can use uses definition and xg beta in all cases. So to be able to do this, you have to actually be able to describe this. This has been done in many cases. So this is done for for threefold X doesn't have to be Calabi-Yau in all genus. So this is due to Aspinall-Morrison was the first case when it's Kubakuma wafer. And so this is Calabi-Yau, but the Pandre extended this to all three folds. And so there is a case here which does not involve multiple covers. So one theorem is that this ng beta x are integral if c1 tx beta is not zero. So this is for freefold x. So this means no multiple covers. And because there's no multiple covers, that's a lot easier. And that one nobody knows how to do. So this is also done. So our case when it's done, this is fourfold, four and fivefold Calabi-Yau's.
You do that by computing F?
What?
You prove that theorem of yours by computing this F?
No. So the F, the transform, which should be, is computed in planetary ponders. The way you make a conjecture, you have to figure out what the relationship should be. The way you prove it is you establish this. You establish the number of curves finite. So there's no multiple covers, so it makes it easier. So if you take a generic J in a freefold, all the curves actually will be isolated. You have to impose some constraints for this to work. So you can also do this for four and fivefold Calabi-Yau freefolds. You can do it for total space. Okay, you can do it for genus zero. So this includes this total space of negative bundles. You can also do it for disks and higher genus open invariants. So in many cases, you can actually compute things. You can actually compute Gromov-Witten invariants in many cases. And these integrality predictions actually say something specific about number, something specific about number theory. Sometimes get statements about number theory. So I'll finish with this very specific example. So if you take x to be O of minus 1 plus O of minus 2 over P1, then so the integrality conjecture is equivalent to the following statement. So define N1 and 2 in Z by the sum of R dividing D N to R equals to minus 1 to the D over 2, 2D, choose D. So for example, N1 is 1, or minus 1, minus 1. So this gives you some kind of, you just do it for each D. This is for all D. And 2 is 4. And 3 is minus 9, and 4 is 32. So.
Equivalent to the n's being integers.
What? Which is?
What's the problem? Okay.
Those n's are integers by definition. There's no problem. Those are not quite the curve counts. I already normalized them to make it easier. So the conjecture is here is that r squared divides n r. So and a lot of them reduce to statement. A lot of them imply statements like this in specific cases. So I'll stop here. In this particular case, yes. In this special case, yes.
You prove it by, you say, proving this discreteness. In the cases that you proved it,
Yeah. Yes. So I first established that this holds.
But you said some finiteness.
Yes. So first statement establishes that the number of curves, if you impose enough constraints, is finite.
And is that a diophantine statement or geometric? I mean, that itself.
It's a geometric statement.
So
the way you prove it is that each one is super rigid. You cannot deform a curve in a normal direction if you impose the constraints. And compactness argument gives finiteness. And to establish Pandey-Pandras theorem, you have to show that the abstraction bundles that he used, which come from complex geometry, are isomorphic to the abstraction bundles that you get here, which are almost complex geometry.
And you don't have an elementary proof of this conjecture?
What? No, I don't have any proof.
So that's a challenge.
Yeah. So in fact, I had it on my... on the website for the math club at Stony Brook.
Better talk. My experience is if you're given to a small method, they can't do it as well.
Great. Well, thank you.
All right,
thank you.
Do any of these become closer to use more fancy techniques from diophantine geometry for finite?
I mean,
that's eventually a
compactness. Yes. But I mean, in principle, this statement does not have to be true for the other statement to be true.
I understand.
But I mean, I don't see any other possible approach to this.
Okay.